Information to Trump. I can't tell you how extraordinary that is.
The president has told Mueller Roger Stone never told him about WikiLeaks, and he said he didn't know about the Trump Tower meeting.
The special counsel has the evidence that can corroborate or dispute that contention.
I just can't for the life of me understand why more of us here in the Senate aren't concerned about this investigation.
This is New Day with Allison Camerota and John Berman.
Yes, I am accepting compliments on my dress right now, John.
She was very upset
yes,
that no
I
one
am.
Had said anything until about 30 seconds ago. It was
and
ruining the
Asha
whole morning.
Complimented it, and now we can begin the show. Thank you, Asha.
I really do appreciate it, Asha. Thank
Welcome
you.
Welcome to our viewers in the United States and around the world. This is New Day. It is Thursday, November 29th, 6 o'clock here in New York. We begin with Robert Mueller's investigation and the president's reaction to it. In an interview with the New York Post, President Trump dangled the possibility of a pardon for his former campaign chairman, Paul Manafort, saying, quote, it was never discussed, but I wouldn't take it off the table. Why would I take it off the table? The president has cast Manafort and other targets of the Mueller probe as victims of prosecutorial aggression. Manafort was convicted of 8 felonies, and he
didn't answer to Robert Mueller. This was part of the take-home open book exam. The president told Mueller, and here are the key words, to the best of his recollection, he did not know about the 2016 Trump Tower meeting promising Russian dirt on Hillary Clinton, and that Roger Stone never told him about WikiLeaks and the hacked Democratic emails. To the best of his recollection. That is not a no. Any lawyer will tell you that is a major hedge, and any good lawyer will advise you to hedge just like that. It's also worth noting that President Trump brags of having, quote, one of the great memories of all time. Finally, the Washington Post is picking up on reporting that CNN did last week that the special counsel has been looking at phone logs of conversations between President Trump and Roger Stone. We have a lot to discuss with CNN political analyst David Gregory and John Avalon, also former FBI special agent Asha Rangappa. Friends, there are those who might look at all of this and say it's just a bunch of small threads that will lead nowhere. There are those who might suggest that. However, I think when you take a giant step back, what you're seeing here is a big consistent theme, and we're seeing very clearly now where the special counsel is focused. To wit, he's very focused on whether people connected to Donald Trump were trying to coordinate the release of the hacked emails. He's very focused on whether the president knew about it or was told about it. He is collecting evidence to this effect. That evidence might lead nowhere, but he's trying to get it. And finally, the president is freaked out about it, and his legal team is also. We saw that over the last 3 weeks when he was agitated. We saw that when he delayed turning in his written answers. And we see it on Twitter now, where he begins his morning and ends his nights by railing on the special counsel investigation. And maybe we're seeing it by the fact he's dangling pardons to the likes of Paul Manafort. Asha, is this a key moment when you step back in the investigation? Are we starting to see Mueller closing in and maybe wrapping up?
He's definitely closing in on what his mandate is about, which is to explore the links of any coordination between Russia and members of the campaign of Russia's efforts to interfere. And when he's gotten to Stone and Corsi, Stone, who is noted in Mueller's documents as being in frequent contact with the president, you are starting to see what collusion would look like, definitely among this inner circle, and if Stone was communicating with the president himself, potentially.
David Gregory, if I had a dollar for every time John Berman said it looks like Robert Mueller is getting close to wrapping up, I'd be at Starbucks, because a lot costs $5, and that's about how many times he's said it, okay?
I actually bought this sport jacket with all the money I earned from John predicting the end.
But that's from a thrift store, so that doesn't say anything.
I mean, it is very interesting to get these nuggets from Robert Mueller and for us to attempt to put the pieces together, but we don't know if he's close or not close. I mean, the concentric circles that we've talked about, maybe they're getting tighter. Who knows?
Well, I think there's a couple of key things. One, the president has submitted his written answers to the special prosecutor. I think that's important. Mueller has spent so much time with other people in Trump's orbit. He wanted to get the president on record. He now has that. He can then challenge him with information that he's known up until now. I think that's a key point. Also, the president's level of agitation does tell us something. I think he's from the very beginning wanted to influence this investigation, influence the outcome, win the political war over this investigation if he has enough confidence that he himself will be spared charges. I don't know how he'd know that even at this point, given he can't know despite whatever insight he has into what Mueller is after, into what a final report would look like. But I think that the fact that there's such a focus on, we know that Russia was trying to interfere, did they find a partner at any level within the Trump campaign or within his orbit? That's what the meeting at Trump Tower is about. That's what the tie is to the release of these WikiLeaks emails. And now it's very stark. There are witnesses who know about this meeting. We know from CNN's reporting that the president said he doesn't recall these meetings. So now the stage is set for who knows what and who's actually telling the truth.
You earned the velour jacket.
Thank you.
With that response.
I had to say it extra.
Velour.
I had to wait to get the velour.
I thought that was at least velvet.
But it was worth every cent of it. David talked about the president being agitated, and people remarked yesterday, John, when the president in this interview with his hometown paper, not just any hometown paper, the New York Post, probably his favorite hometown paper, went out of
John Barrett's favorite paper.
Yeah,
sure.
Too. Went out of his way to say that pardoning Paul Manafort is not off the table. Now, I don't know what Paul Manafort knows or doesn't know. I do know the president answered that question differently yesterday than he has before.
Yeah, and that's not subtle, especially given the timing, especially given the fact that folks are now saying, look, you know what, were Manafort's lawyers back-channeling with Trump's lawyers in a way that was perhaps setting up a context or maybe some kind of quid pro quo? Highly questionable, but it's unusual for a guy like Paul Manafort, who's taken a plea deal, to have his lawyers be communicating with the president. By the way, it's also odd for the president to be this in bed with folks who are under active investigation of pled guilty to a federal prosecutor. But let's put that Captain Obvious point aside for a second. Look, Jerome Corsi's own statements now seem to be fishing for a plea deal. This seems, this seems to be sort of plan D for people, that the Donald will come in for them at the very end of the day. This is troubling. This also comes not only in an agitated president, but in the context of the president retweeting a meme about putting his political opponents in jail.
Let's put that up so people can see what John's talking about here.
Okay, this is nuts, people. The president of the United States retweeting an image of putting his political opponents in jail. And I would note, there are folks, not just political opponents, but people directly involved in the investigation, including three Republicans, including the assistant attorney general, who he said, when asked about it, Rod Rosenstein, he said, well, you know, he never should have appointed the special prosecutor. Therefore, that's why I retweeted. That's why he's in there. I was aware of that. And that, to me, is a jailable offense, at least in the fantasy baseball world of Twitter and Donald Trump. These are all signs of someone who's not particularly well, someone who's under a great deal of pressure, and someone who's dangling pardons in public to his former campaign chair.
All right, well, hold on a second.
I'm
just not buying it. Of course a pardon for Paul Manafort isn't off the table. Nothing is ever off the table with Donald Trump. He told his foreign advisors, why can't we use nuclear weapons?
Well,
nuclear war isn't off the table for President Trump. Surely a pardon is not off the table.
Okay, that is true as kind of a theoretical matter. What is notable is that he is saying this out loud. And from a legal perspective, this is problematic for him. Yes, the president has very broad pardon power. He could pardon Manafort. But dangling a pardon is something different.
Mm-hmm.
It is offering to use your presidential power in order to encourage or entice or influence somebody's behavior. That is a separate act. And that can also be evidence of obstruction. So he's going nuts because I can tell you his lawyers are telling him, shut up, stop talking about pardons. If you're going to do it, just wait and do it.
Isn't that also that we're doing the work for them? If Paul Manafort wanted to know if a pardon was possible, now he says it to the New York Post. The New York Post puts it out. We broadcast it. They're having this conversation through the media now.
Except, Allison, I think you're right that it is true that it's just like, well, I'm just saying it out there. Except they also had a joint defense agreement where these lawyers were in contact. And what I want to know is, and I'm sure Mueller wants to know, is did this come up in those conversations? Because if it did, then he's in a lot of hot water.
Well,
don't call me Shirley.
You have to wonder what Manafort is thinking, right? He serves two masters at this point. He serves the special prosecutor and he serves Trump.
And Russia.
It's a risky, proposition, the idea that he's going to bank on some kind of pardon. But, you know, what we've seen from the president almost from the start in firing Jim Comey, in calling out Rosenstein, firing the attorney general, putting in a sympathetic attorney general who we know is opposed to this investigation. allegation. He signaled from the very beginning that he will go right up to the line and perhaps cross it to actually undermine this investigation, not just take it on politically before the report ever comes and before Mueller's work is ever done, but this is a president who will actively undermine the credibility, the validity of the investigation, and that work on his part continues, which, and I agree with John, I mean, it's a sign of his agitation, it's a sign of how much pressure he feels over this, and I'm sure of what he's stressed about is what he doesn't and can't know at this point, as well as just not taking it seriously.
There was a combined sigh and head nod there.
Really? Yeah. Is there a word we can coin for that quickly?
A snod?
A snod? No, I reject that. I want something better. Anyway, look, the point is that one of the ways we can put on the, you know, non-normalization filter on this is to look at presidential precedent. Trump is by far not the first president to be under investigation, express great annoyance at a special prosecutor. Look at Bill Clinton, who felt deeply persecuted by the investigation, the expansion of Whitewater. There wasn't out talk about firing the attorney general, Janet Reno, as far as we know. I mean, he wasn't dangling pardons for people.
Did pardon people. So,
but utterly unrelated to the special prosecution. So that's not a thing. That math doesn't work.
All right. Go ahead. I would
argue respectfully.
Pardon math doesn't work. All right. Go ahead.
My good friend from New Jersey.
Yeah. All of a sudden I became Joe Piscopo there. I'm not sure what happened. Look, the point is that this president is acting in ways that are far outside the norms, and that's how you know it's not remotely normal. And I think we give a pass sometimes, and we say, look, this president's a norm breaker. He's a disruptor. Yes, that's true. But compared to every way other presidents act when they've been under investigation, and this is a stark departure that should not be simply accepted.
Let me focus on the CNN reporting exclusive from yesterday. We know how the president answered some of these questions. And again, it is notable that these questions are focused on the same thing that Jerome Corsi is talking about and Roger Stone is talking about, which is, did the president know about WikiLeaks before the release? He says no, to the best of his recollection. Asha, first of all, just in general, to the best of your recollection, you know, legally speaking, that means what?
That means I'm giving myself a lot of room in case there's evidence that comes up to the contrary.
Okay.
It worked now, for Reagan.
It did. And any good lawyer, David Gregory knows this better than anyone, will tell you that you want a hedge like that. You're going to say, to the best of you. In my memory, I don't remember talking about that. Here's the thing, though, is that President Trump tells us he's got not just a good, but among the greatest memories. Listen.
I have one of the great memories of all time.
People know me for my memory.
I have a very good memory.
I have a good memory, like a great memory.
So good, you might think, that you could just say no. Uh-huh. I never talked about WikiLeaks to Roger Stone. No, I didn't know about the Trump Tower meeting beforehand. Not to the best of my memory, David.
Yeah, I mean, we just have to remember that, you know, the president tells a lot of untruths, and those don't matter legally the way his answers to the special prosecutor do. And we know the special prosecutor and his team have talked to lots of people with regard to WikiLeaks, with regard to the meeting, who can say exactly what happened, who was there, and what those conversations were like. And that's where the president is putting himself in a position to hedge, because there may be evidence that comes forward that the president, that Mueller's team already has, that contradicts that recollection. So what he ends up doing with all of that, of course, depends on how much corroboration he's got.
Yeah, but not so fast. Not so fast.
Not so fast.
Mr. Math. unless Mueller has tape recordings of Roger Stone and then-candidate Donald Trump's phone calls, and there's no indication that either of them taped it at the moment, how will he ever know what they discussed on there? All we know is that there were phone calls at pivotal times between Roger Stone, late-night phone calls that have been documented, but we don't know what they discussed, so we have no idea if they discussed WikiLeaks.
Well, I think a pattern of phone calls itself is significant. It's one of the reasons the phone call to the undisclosed number from Don Jr. after the Russia meeting is significant, which the president has now officially denied on the record. Look, you've had a lot of people in the Trump orbit saying there was no way Donald Trump was talking to Roger Stone on the regular. That appears not to be true now. It could be what was told to other people, but you're right. Look, this isn't going to be necessarily a question of taping,
not going to know what they discussed.
Well, easy on that. Hold on. Sorry. Just one really important point on this. The president's statement, even though there's some weasel words in there from legal language, this is significant. because now he could be liable to criminal charges because this is on the record. This is not Kellyanne Conway's, you know, no one makes you take an oath when you go on television. This isn't the president being performative. This is actually a legal document, and there are consequences for lying.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, there are a lot of times in legal cases where you're not going to have the Scooby-Doo moment where you're like, ah, you know, it's the caretaker.
I love it.
You know, but...
Now I understand, by the way.
All of a sudden, right.
You know, let's just look at how loquacious Stone has been in his emails. Uh-huh. You know, it is simply writing to someone and saying, I spoke with the president. And so there can be, you know, documentation of conversations that have been had, communicating, especially if there was coordination, instructions or approvals or something like that that could show up if that was what was happening. And if it's not, then as you know, as Don said, we would just have the pattern of phone calls, which might be corroborative of things themselves.
You know who made the same?
All right, the U.S. Senate has rebuked President Trump's handling of advanced a bill that would end U.S. support of the Saudi Arabia-led war in Yemen. This came hours after the Secretary of State and Defense Secretary briefed senators, but many of them were still angry that the CIA director was not there. We're back with David Gregory, John Avalon, and Asha Rangappa. Asha, let's just start with Secretary of State Mike Pompeo explaining why Gina Haspel, head of the CIA, who has heard the tape of Khashoggi's murder, did not go to brief senators. So listen to this.
I was asked to be here, and here I am.
But senators were very frustrated. Normally, in your past role as CIA director, you would be here briefing these senators on an issue this sensitive. Why isn't the CIA director herself here?
I was asked to be here, and I'm here.
Okay, I was wrong. That wasn't an answer. sorry about that.
It was word said out loud.
Yeah. Why wouldn't they want, I mean, don't we want all the information? This seems to be willful blindness. There is a tape that exists. It's probably horrible. It's probably very horrible to listen to. But she's heard it. Why would they not want that information?
Because they don't want actual evidence of somebody who's listened to the tape, who has looked at the intelligence and assessed with high confidence in their conclusion that MSM was behind this. I also think that there is a huge problem here in terms of Congress's oversight function. I mean, this isn't, you know, an official hearing or something, but ever since the Church hearings where, you know, the CIA had to come and talk about what they knew and what they were doing, there has been an understanding that when they want to know what's happening in the intelligence realm, that is going to be offered, barring any kind of, you know, yeah, highly classified sensitive
and
situation.
And let's be clear, the answer to the question Mike Pompeo wouldn't answer is that Gina Haspel was going to go there, and she'd been to Turkey, and she'd heard the tapes, and she'd overseen a U.S. intelligence community saying with high confidence that this occurred, and she was not going to toe the president's line, which has been from the beginning, even when he was denying and defending and trying to spin things in the Saudis' direction, that this is simply an inconvenient murder for U.S. geopolitics and for the administration. And so he wants it to go away. And being forced to confront facts he didn't want to confront, they're minimizing it with op-eds from the Secretary of State in a disgraceful op-ed yesterday, basically saying we're going to give Saudi a pass on this. This is Gina Haspel. And the CIA was not going to toe the party line. And that's why she didn't.
And we saw something unusual, which is Congress stepping in and saying enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Enough from the president, including Republicans who normally line up behind the president. And Lindsey Graham explained why. Let's listen.
I'm glad we had it. I admire both secretaries, but it was inadequate because the CIA was not there. Any key vote, anything that you need me for to get out of town, I ain't doing it until we hear from the CIA.
Have you made that clear to the president?
I just did.
David Gregory. It is unusual.
When Lindsey Graham gets all colloquial on us, we know things are getting real. And but I think it's interesting, back to the Gina Haspel point, which is, look, she was dispatched over there to get the ground truth about what happened, and she had a conclusion, and that conclusion is public, and as has been said, the rest of the administration is marginalizing that view. And it was very interesting that Jim Mattis, the defense secretary, would go out so publicly and say, look, there's no smoking gun that would reveal the crown prince was behind this. But I think Lindsey Graham, speaking for Republicans and Democrats, said no, he's going to push to get the CIA more involved. And to scrutinize administration policy toward Saudi Arabia. I think this is significant. This is the president's own party pushing back hard. And when the president issued his own conclusions about this in that very strange statement that he issued last week, he said, you know, he'll listen to Congress, but whatever they propose has to be in line with his thinking about the U.S. relationship with Saudi Arabia. This whole thing has been unseemly, which unfortunately a lot of our relationship with the Saudis is and has been for decades.
I think that it's so interesting, though, that the repercussion of Jamal Khashoggi's murder. And so this bipartisan vote, some Democrats like Chris Murphy, who we'll be having on the show, have been wanting the U.S. to get out of the Saudi-led military action in Yemen for years and was never able to break the logjam until yesterday. Yeah. And I mean, that's one of Jamal Khashoggi's legacies. That this, as a result, had he not been murdered, this wouldn't be happening.
Right. And I think what you're seeing, as John mentioned, is Congress actually starting to assert its role in the separation of powers framework, which they've been unwilling and unable to do in this domestic, you know, investigation and all of that. And so I think you're going to see the president starting to see now, you know, he has this pushback. When the Dems take control in January, there's going to be pushback, and he's going to face a new situation and on a lot of different fronts that I think he hasn't until now.
But I do think it's significant that one truth about this administration has been how stalwart the relationship has been with Israel and Saudi Arabia in order to counter Iran. If there's a foreign policy priority, it has been that, and I don't see that changing, and therefore I don't see the posture toward Yemen changing unless there's enough pressure to do so.
You could literally get away with murder, and you will, and that will not adjust the larger posture to these particular countries. But it's significant that when this same issue came up in a vote in March, 44 senators voted for it. Now you had 64. That's a significant sea change. And if you get, anytime you get a coalition between Bernie Sanders and Mike Lee, I mean, it's probably positive in the larger ability to reason together. But this is, it may be a symbolic vote. Yemen is something that hasn't captured enough folks' attention given the proxy war. You know, but I believe the New York Times estimate 85,000 children may have died of starvation in that country. And the U.S. is involved. And Saudi is, of course, directly involved or via proxy. So this is maybe a symbolic vote, but it's a significant one because that 20-vote shift indicates that maybe, just maybe, Congress is finding a backbone again.
You're talking about, Asha was talking about, when Democrats take control. The president, in the interview with the New York Post, gave us a sense of where he might go when Democrats take control of the House in January. In addition to talking about The Apprentice, he threatened them. He said he will declassify information that will be embarrassing to Democrats. He says, quote, "I think that would help my campaign. If they want to play tough, I will do it. They will see how devastating those pages are." Does that fill you with comfort and joy this holiday season, David Gregory, to hear the president?
No, it doesn't. No? And when, after the midterms, the president was very clear that, you know, he'd work with Democrats as long as they work with him. Other than that, he threatened them to use other branches of the government against them. I think threatening Democrats, I think threatening Mueller, threatening judges, this has become the normal MO for this president, who stands up to these kinds of checks and balances. We had the Chief Justice, we've had others in other aspects of the government saying, no, we will exercise that right. And this is the kind of fight that he may have to have with Nancy Pelosi, and these checks and balances have to survive.
But John, what are these classified documents that might embarrass them? Isn't it about the Russia investigation? Why would these embarrass Democrats?
You know, I think probably the closest parallel is I have in my hand here the names of 200 people in the State Department. This is a smear tactic. It's a fear tactic. It's the stuff we saw Joe McCarthy and other folks try to pull out. Don't overthink it. This is pure fear and anger and intimidation. And the fact and the idea that it's based in anything real, we shouldn't assume that at all.
It's an empty threat. I mean, every time that we've heard something about the FISA, for example, it's actually vindicated the process and how it was done. But I think this is starting to look like 50 ways to commit obstruction or something. Because, again,
that's the least popular pulse on the
exactly.
side, by the way.
Exactly. It was very hard to rhyme with obstruction. Get on the bus, obstruction. Make a new plan, obstruction.
It's also not a best-selling book.
When you're abusing your power in order to get some kind of self-benefit, which is to prevent Democrats from performing their lawful functions, which is oversight, investigation, whatever it is they want to do, that starts to look like obstruction, and it could be an impeachable offense. I mean, you can't abuse your power that way.
Asha, David, John, thank you very, very much, and our apologies to Paul Simon. So the Kremlin has made it official. The Russian leader Vladimir Putin and the president of the United States, Donald Trump, will meet this weekend. Will the president confront Putin about the clash with Ukraine, the fact that Russia is, you know, has Ukrainian ships, things like that? We'll have a live report next.
Anti-Semitism and hate crimes rise.
Trump on Saturday on the sidelines of the G20 summit in Buenos Aires. This is tensions escalate with Ukraine after the naval clash there. CNN's Nick Peyton Walsh live in Ukraine at a military facility near the Sea of Azov. Nick.
John, you join me here on the edge of the Sea of Azov, where last Sunday this clash began, a week of tension now escalating with this likely meeting, it seems, in Argentina. Oddly, it's the Kremlin confirming that will happen, speaking on behalf, it seems, of the White House. Now, Donald Trump has said he was unhappy at Russian aggression in the straits near where I'm standing and might cancel the meeting, but has since gone silent, leaving it, it seems, to Moscow to say whether it will happen or not. Around me here is the Ukrainian military show of strength. We've seen their attack helicopters fly over us, and you may hear distantly in the background the crackle of anti-aircraft gunfire. They're keen to show their readiness for any potential future military action, and we have heard from people along this sea here on the Kerch Strait their general anxiety, frankly, at the Ukrainian government, at the military's readiness to some degree, and also at Russian aggression too. This economy suffered here deeply, but Wolf Petro Poroshenko, the Ukrainian president, has introduced martial law here. As we drove through the country last night, we didn't see many overt signs of that. And we certainly have heard him call for more support from the European Union. But it really is all eyes again on Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin. The commander-in-chief seems to think he has a good one-on-one rapport with the Kremlin head to perhaps turn his mind, change his hand here. But remember last time in Helsinki, what happened then? Quite so well, I think, for those who expected Donald Trump to condemn Russian interference in elections. We'll have to see if the meeting goes ahead in Argentina. We haven't had that confirmed from Washington yet, exactly where that leads. Back to you.
Nick, we will be talking to various U.S. lawmakers this morning on the program and ask them what they plan next. Thank you very much. All right, if you thought that Frosty only had to worry about melting, watch this. Some Grinch stabs the inflatable snowman. And look, it's as if he's melting right there into the parking lot. It's all caught on video. We have to find this Grinch, John.
I want to know the story behind this.
Oh, I've got it for you.
Roadside bombing in Afghanistan this week. Army Captain Andrew Ross, Army Sergeant First Class Eric Emond, and Air Force Staff Sergeant Dylan Elkin. The Taliban claimed responsibility for the attack near the city of Ghazni. It is the deadliest attack against U.S. service members in Afghanistan this year.
CNN has learned the Trump administration is planning to announce a ban on bump stocks in the coming days. The country learned about bump stocks last year when a gunman in Las Vegas rigged his weapon with the device to murder 58 people at an outdoor concert. President Trump promised to ban bump stocks shortly after that massacre. Under the new rule, bump stock owners would be required to destroy or surrender their devices to authorities within 90 days.
The FDA has narrowed the source of E. coli contamination from romaine lettuce to six counties in California: Monterey, San Benito, San Luis Obispo, Santa Barbara, Santa Cruz, and Ventura counties. Officials say romaine lettuce harvested outside these regions is not related to the multi-state outbreak, but they're advising consumers, if you don't know where your romaine was grown, don't eat it. If you see something, say something.
Got it. All right, here, John, this is an important story that you've been waiting for. An assault on a snowman in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Someone stabbed, as you'll see here, an inflatable Frosty the Snowman outside a local hotel. Take a look at this surveillance video. Police need your help. You can see Frosty quickly deflating after that heartless Grinch slashed him last week.
They came out and approached, running up to him and then just stabbed him. No reason. Frosty did nothing to them.
No reason?
No reason.
As if there would be a reason
Maybe
to stab Frosty?
Frosty had angered him somehow.
What Frosty has done nothing to nobody except spread Christmas and winter joy.
I agree with you. Frosty has made a miraculous recovery, we're happy to report. He's back on his feet, greeting hotel guests.
He's taped up.
Although he is sporting a nasty scar.
But I love the framing of that. He stabbed Frosty for no reason.
But by the way, we have a shot of the guy driving away. Can't we get his license plate? I'm going to get Dolly Parton on it. Isn't she from Pigeon Forge, Tennessee?
Is she?
I think she's from, or Pigeon Hollow.
I've been to Dollywood, you know.
Yeah, it
was right after college, and I couldn't. If we got there, it was like $30 to go in, so I was there with my then girlfriend, now wife. And we're like, we drove all the way here, but we don't have enough money to go.
That's a tragic story. And
someday
we're
I'll go back
amends.
To Dollywood.
Yes. Fantastic.
All right, First Lady Melania Trump standing by her Christmas decorations after lots of social media critics jeered at the red Christmas trees inside the White House. A lot of jeering. CNN's Jeannie Most explains.
The president counted down. The First Lady pressed the button to light the national Christmas tree.
2, 1.
A nice, normal green tree. Technically a blue spruce, but when it came to sprucing up the White House, 40 red cranberry-covered trees lining the East Colonnade had some critics seeing red, or at least seeing car wash brushes, or seeing the women from The Handmaid's Tale with their bonnets.
Am I correct, girls?
You are correct if you thought the red trees would become the butt of jokes.
Soaked in blood. Soaked in sweet, sweet blood.
Oh, check these out. Yeah. A lot of people said it looks like Christmas in hell. Then Melania said, exactly.
But you know what Melania really said?
We are in 21st century and everybody has a different taste. I think they look fantastic. In real life, they look even more beautiful.
Supporter, I think the red trees are as fashion forward as she is. I love them.
Oh, come on. You regular trees are just green with envy.
The First Lady's office said the red motif is an extension of the stripes found on the presidential seal, and the Be Best ornaments are an extension of Melania's campaign encouraging kids. The First Lady seems to like red, right down to her fingertips, tweeted someone, "The gloves are killing me. Is it cold, or is she trying not to leave fingerprints?" Twitter users needled the red trees by inserting the creepy girls from The Shining.
Rebuking President Trump with a vote about Saudi Arabia. We'll talk with the senator behind the measure next.
I always knew you had
it. President Trump, in a new interview with the New York Post, is now publicly touting the possibility of pardoning Paul Manafort. Joining us now to talk about this and so much more is Democratic Senator Chris Murphy. He serves on the Foreign Relations Committee, and he sponsored a resolution passed by the Senate to end U.S. support of Saudi Arabia, the Saudi Arabian-led war in Yemen. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning.
Okay. Do you take the idea that President Trump floated this idea in the New York Post that, pardoning Paul Manafort, that's not off the table. Is that for real, or is that just to wind up Democrats?
Who knows? I think you have to take him at his word. There's lots of things that he's said over the course of the last 2 years that we thought were just bluster that he actually followed through on. And so ultimately, I assume that he's trying to continue to give reasons for those who might tell a story about the president that could get him in serious trouble, especially with the House Democratic majority, to stop talking. I think we all have to take seriously the potential that he may pardon Manafort. Now, I think if he was ever to do that, that would be a line that would be too far for.
You think that as you sit here today, that the Republicans who have supported the president in the past through all sorts of other convention breaking moments, that would be the Rubicon for them?
I mean, not every Senate Republican, but I think there's a significant number of Senate Republicans who would see that as a legitimate constitutional crisis in a way that they have not seen previous transgressions by this president. That's my belief. I understand that I might have the football pulled out from under me when that moment happens, if it happens.
Okay, let's talk about what happened in the Senate yesterday. So you sponsored a couple of really significant things. First, the pulling of U.S. support for the Saudi Arabian-led action in Yemen. You have been, I think, wanting to do this for a long time, but yesterday was the moment. How do you explain that after 3 years of you trying to talk about this, what crystallized, even for your Republican colleagues yesterday?
Well, you know, let's just get the benchmarks down. Since the civil war began in Yemen that the United States is participating in, we're helping the Saudis bomb Yemen. 85,000 children under the age of 5 have died of starvation and disease. The world's worst ever cholera epidemic has broken out in that country. 3/4 of the population lives only on humanitarian assistance. Why did we get 14 Republicans yesterday? Well, first, I think they have seen that this administration has no plans to wrap up this war, and they have seen that the targeting of civilians by the Saudis has gotten worse and worse. So I think Republicans have paid attention to the worsening humanitarian situation. But second, Khashoggi clearly plays into their calculus because they had believed the Saudis when they told them that, hey, listen, we're not hitting civilians on purpose in Yemen. It's all a bunch of mistakes. And then when they lied to our face for 2 weeks about what happened to Jamal Khashoggi, they all of a sudden started to think, well, wait a second, maybe the Saudis aren't telling us the truth about what's happening inside Yemen. So I think it's the facts on the ground, but it's also the fact that the Senate felt the need to send a real message to Saudi Arabia that we think it's time to start rethinking the entire nature of our relationship.
And is that the backstory that led to this moment that we have on tape where Senator Lindsey Graham comes up to you at a moment during this vote, and he comes over to you and he shakes his hand? I think we have it in a second. You'll see it, hopefully spot shadowed. And Graham, he's waving and he's making some gestures, and he comes over. Oh, yes, he makes his vote, and then he comes over and shakes your hand. Did that moment surprise you?
Well, you know, I've spent a lot of time with Lindsey over the last 3 years. Senator Graham has been the probably strongest backer of the Saudis, the strongest opponent of the resolutions that I've brought to the floor to try to change our relationship with Saudi Arabia. And I spent a lot of time with him on the floor yesterday. He eventually did change his vote. He initially voted with the administration, and then, as you saw there, changed his vote to vote with us. I think that Senator Graham feels really personally aggrieved by the Saudis, who he has been a primary backer of. And when they lied to us for 2 to 3 weeks about what happened to Jamal Khashoggi, when they lied to him, I think it caused him and many other Republicans to question whether the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is being straight with us about a lot of other things. If they are truly purposefully targeting civilians, school buses, hospitals inside of Yemen, then the United States can't be involved in that. That's war crimes. And I think a lot of Republicans, including Lindsey Graham, are coming around to that potential reality.
As you know, the president and his Secretary of State disagree. They do continue to trust the Crown Prince's story on this. In fact, the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, had written this op-ed. The gist of it was, we don't condone Jamal Khashoggi's murder, but the kingdom is a powerful force for Mideast stability. You called that op-ed, quote, bananas. And then the Secretary of State, in response, said this yesterday. So listen to this.
I do believe I've read every piece of intelligence, unless it's come in the last few hours. I think I've read it all. There is no direct reporting connecting the Crown Prince to the order to murder Jamal Khashoggi. That's all I can say in an unclassified setting.
In case you couldn't hear that bad audio, he said there is no direct reporting connecting the Crown Prince to the order to murder Jamal Khashoggi. How would you classify that statement?
So who knows what direct reporting means? Is there a smoking gun? Is there a tape in which Mohammed bin Salman admits that he personally ordered the dismemberment of Jamal Khashoggi? No, there probably isn't. But that's not how intelligence works. Intelligence works by picking up all sorts of different pieces of information and assembling a story. And that is why reporting has suggested that the CIA says that they believe that Khashoggi's murder was ordered, directed by Mohammed bin Salman. And so I guess he's technically correct that there's no direct reporting, but there's all sorts of evidence to tell us that nothing like this would ever happen without Mohammed bin Salman knowing about it and ordering it. That's just how this elite group has worked for the last several years under his direction and control.
Senator Chris Murphy, we're out of time, but rest assured we do have Senator Ron Johnson coming on in the program to talk about the measure that you both co-sponsored about trying to stamp out Russian aggression against Ukraine. So thank you very much for covering all these topics with us.
Great. Thanks a lot.
John. So last night at 11:39 p.m., the president was writing about the Russia investigation. This morning at 6:54 a.m., the president is writing about the Russia investigation. Do you think he's being